Hi, I'm Gayle Laakmann McDowell, author of Cracking the Coding Interview. Today I want to talk about the make change problem. So we want to give someone a certain amount of money, and we have a list of all the denominations. And the question is, how many different ways can we do that? So let's walk through this for a particular possibility. Suppose we want to make 27 cents out of these coins here. Well, the first thing we need to figure out is, well, how many quarters are we going to give? Are we going to give one quarter or are we going to give zero quarters? We can't give any more than that. Once we've decided how many quarters to give out, our problem has actually been reduced. If we give out zero quarters, then now we're just trying to make 27 cents from just dimes, nickels, and pennies. If we give out one quarter, then we're trying to just make 2 cents from the remaining options, which obviously there aren't a whole lot of ways of doing that. Now we just repeat this process. So how many ways are there of making change, of making 27 cents from dimes, nickels, and pennies? Well, let's go through the different options. We could give zero dimes, let's start with dimes, go zero dimes, one dime, or two dimes. And same thing for this other one, but the possibilities are much more limited there. So if we keep going through this process, we'll eventually get to the point where we have a definitive answer. So if we're saying how many ways are there of making change from 17 cents given just pennies, that's one. If we're saying how many ways can we make change of 17 cents from just a 2 cent piece, so this is with different denominations, that's going to be zero. And those will be our base cases. So let's try a new example here with a bigger values and a little bit more denominations. So suppose we're trying to make 79 cents from half dollars, quarters, dimes, nickels, and pennies. So one option we'll explore is making 79 cents with zero half dollars and two quarters, and then the remaining 29 cents from dimes, nickels, and pennies. Another option, though, that we'll explore is making 79 cents from one half dollar and zero quarters, and the remaining 29 cents from dimes, nickels, and pennies. So note that these two paths have reduced to the same subproblem. So although we got to them in a different way, one uses 50 cents, a 50 cent piece, and the other one uses two quarters, they have the same subproblem. So we don't need to compute this twice. Once we've computed it once, just store it for future problems. So that said, let's turn to the code now. Whenever I do a memoization problem, I like to start off with just a straightforward recursive approach because it helps me wrap my head around the problem a little bit better. So this is a make change function, and it's just gonna be straightforward recursion. It's going to return a long so that I can avoid integer overflow, and it's going to take in the denominations and the amount of money. Now, when we just talked through the problem earlier, we had this array basically popping off the first element. That can get kind of inefficient to shift and shrink this array because that actually requires creating a new array. So a better approach is to just pass in some sort of index, which tells us what coin we're currently considering. So what we're going to do is take the first coin, or take whatever index is pointing to, and if it's say 25 cents, consider saying, what if we have one of those, or zero of those, one of those, two of those, etc. And I'm going to come back and add the base cases later. So what I'm going to do is recurse on each of these options. So this is going to be the amount of money we have used from this particular coin. So while amount with coin is less than or equal to the amount of money, then we're gonna say, okay, the amount of money remaining we need to make is it's money minus amount with coin. Then recurse on this. So I'm gonna need some long number of ways. Recurse on this and add that and keep track of that sum as we go. Remaining index plus one. So count how many ways there are of making the remaining amount of money with the remaining coins. And then increment amount with coin by the value of that coin. We could alternatively actually just have amount do go from 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and then multiply that by the size of the coin. Doesn't really matter too much which approach we make. Take, and then return ways. Now my base case is here. Well, if we're out of money, then, so if we have zero cents left, then, well, how many ways are there of making 0 cents with, doesn't really matter what the coins is, then one.
if we've run out of coins but not money, then the options are zero. So if index is greater than or equal to coins.length, then return zero. So that's our recursion. It's always nice to give the caller a little helper function just to wrap that, because it makes it a little bit easier so they don't have to worry about what the parameters are. Okay, now the memoization part. The idea here is that whenever we start to try to recompute the same problem, and we want to say, wait, we've already done this before, return this stored value. The question is, how do we define whether or not we've seen the problem before? Sometimes people will use just money, we'll use some sort of hash map, right, that maps from the problem, however we represent it, to the answer to that problem. So sometimes people will use money as the key in this hash table, and that's actually not sufficient. Just because we're trying to compute the number of ways of making change from 29 cents doesn't mean the coins being used there are the same. So we need a key that actually represents both the money and the index. So we could use a class that wraps both of those, but even simpler is a simple string. So just use a simple string that's basic concatenation of money and index. And then we'll have a memo table that'll be a hash map. The map string from a string to a long, and I'll call that memo. And now I'll say if memo.contains key of key, return memo.get of key. And then the very end here, update my memo table of key comma ways. And when I call this function, I'll pass in that memo table. And then I also need to pass it in down here. Okay. So hopefully this will work. All right. So now one thing I want to point out here that is a very common mistake for candidates to make is this key. So here I've concatenated, basically created a string representation for the money and the index. You want to make sure there's a separator there, because otherwise you could have a situation where you're concatenating, like, you know, let's say 29 plus 1, and that gets confused with 2 plus 91. So just be careful for that. You want to use a little separator there, like a dash will work fine. Just get in that habit. So this is a little bit trickier memoization problem, but it's not overwhelmingly difficult once you get the hang of these problems. So I really encourage you to practice memoization problems a ton. If you want to, as a follow-up kind of extra challenging algorithm, you can flip this around and try to tackle this iteratively. It's a lot trickier, but one tip is think about what is the very last thing that gets filled in on this memo table. And then how can you backtrack and fill in each cell of the memo table based on what work you've done before? So it's a really good exercise that really tests your understanding of this. But it's not something that, at least at this complexity, tends to be asked in interviews. But again, really, really encourage you to practice memoization problems. They're a lot easier once you get the hang of them. Good luck.